Oh, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Families for Him Sunday night event. We have special guest Kevin Welsh and friends, his lovely bride Juanita, and we have Jonathan Golden tickling the ivories. Well, in this case, they're, I don't know if I'd call those ivories, 1993, the white and black keys more like it, but still, it all works indeed. Kevin will be sharing a message with us also today, and then and we'll just kind of see how music evolves here. We're down a few, and we had a few, and by God, God is good and able. So, Brother Kevin, I will hand this over to you, my friend. Got Mr. Microphone working?
Test one, two.
You are.
All right. And so, praise the Lord and welcome, everyone. We are excited to be in this place. I think something good is going to happen. I always expect something good to happen because you get what you expect when you're dealing with our Lord, our Savior. He's looking to do his best, but you got to believe it, you know. And I believe that's what fear is. It's when you actually believe that bad things are going to happen that we get fearful. Well, I'm believing in faith that good things are going to happen. Anybody believing with me? You got something good? Okay, I can work with that. Awesome. So this evening we want to get started with a word of prayer. Okay, we commit all things into God's hand, and I'm sure there's a blessing in store. Just bow your heads briefly. Father Almighty, we thank you that this is now the time where we are preparing to give honor and glory to you through song, through words, through our hearts, just opening up and just ministering. And God, in all the ways you see fit, pour into our lives, God. Fill the cracks. Forgive us, God, if there's any hindrance, anything that is not like you, anything that would have caused us to doubt, to not be in faith, anything that caused hurt, and we may be now in a place where we are coming from that, God, I just pray you would cause us to forget what's behind us and stay in this moment that's now. Bless us indeed and enlarge your territory. Allow your hand to be upon us. And as we praise you, God, that you be glorified and your people will be edified. We ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Amen. And so this evening we want to share just a few songs with you. They're worship songs for me. It's just a part of entering in. We have a God who is a lover. I'm saying like that. He is a lover. He is the lover. How do I know that? Because John 3:16 says, "For God, the greatest lover, so loved, the greatest expression, this world, the greatest congregation that he gave." That's the greatest sacrifice, his only begotten son. That whosoever, and that's the greatest gift, by the way, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish but have everlasting life. So we are going to just go into worship because he is exalted. Because of what he has done, we exalt him. So he is exalted on high. You can sing along with us. It's on the screen.
Heaven and earth.
you know how he's exalted? When you lift him up. When you make him first in your life. That's what happens when we get up in the morning, first thing. Before you put your feet on the floor, you better remember who gave you those feet. You better be glad you still have those feet. Understand who steadies your steps, because you could get out of the bed, slip and fall. But God is the one who keeps our feet from stumbling. So I'm telling you, he's worthy. All right? And so we trust God. I trust God. And it's a daily practice. Don't ever get, it never gets old. You can only get better with it. Like fine wine. Like my beautiful wife. It's only as time goes on that we get better, right? With God. And so the next song just says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Isaiah 40, 31 just tells us that even the young men, the young people will get weary. But those of us that wait on the God of heaven, our strength will be restored. And I trust God to fulfill his promise in you. So this song just says, they that wait upon the Lord.
Upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They will mount up with wings like the eagle. They shall run. See, they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Oh, teach me, Lord. Teach me, Lord. That wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as the eagle. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Oh, teach me, Lord.
One more time.
They wait upon the Lord,
our God,
shall renew their strength. Said they shall mount up with wings as the eagle, as they shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Oh, teach me, Lord. Upon the Lord our God shall renew their strength. See, they shall mount up with wings as the eagle. And they shall run, we run, and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Oh, here we go.
Teach me, Lord. Say, teach me, Lord.
We went one more round than we had planned. But you know what? The Holy Spirit was on me to say, look, this is a prayer request. And when you ask, you got to ask with persistence. And so I said, teach me, Lord. That is my prayer. Because I still have a problem with waiting on God for some things. Tell the truth. I'm not alone. I'm in good company, right? I'm exposing it all tonight. All right? Some things we have to learn to wait on. We want it now. And when God holds back some things, we get a little impatient and we try to help God out. But we just want to trust God. So we exalt him. We exalt him in the beginning. We're going to exalt him in the end.
Amen.
Amen. Because he's worthy. Sure. So the song just says, we exalt thee. We exalt thee. Oh, hallelujah. We exalt thee. Yourself. Because when God shows up, he shows up to fix something. He is the all-sufficient God. Bible calls him Jehovah Jireh. The God who is the God of provision. He lacks nothing. Everything you have, he is God. He's ready to give it to you. But it says he who comes to God must first believe that God is God. He can give you or reward you when you diligently seek him. So I encourage you to stay on your seats tonight. Whatever your prayer needs are, whatever your personal needs are, is it health? Is it finances? Is it peace? Whatever it is, I promise you, the God that I know, the God that I serve, he can absolutely deliver. Just sing one more round for me. Just, I want you to just enter in here with me. Just say, we exalt thee. We exalt thee. He's going to come close to you as we sing this.
So we exalt thee. We exalt thee. We
special song you and your lovely bride were going to sing, is that right?
Yes, we'll do that just before
okay.
We go to the message.
So what are we doing now? On our normal, but remember I told you, all okay. Things go, baby.
Okay.
And right. You can tell we're so connected, we're yep. So scheduled here, yep. Right? It's good. So this would be the time where we normally would start sharing a message.
Oh, I see.
So would you okay. Like to do so? Or do okay. You have something else you want to
do? Sure, sure, sure. We can do that.
What would you like to do?
We will do that. We'll go ahead and we'll do that.
Okay.
I thought we had a pause in between there. And so this song that we're going to share with you, is a personal testimony. We serve God. Because as I said to you, God will reward those who seek him, but you must first believe that God is. If you have 10 fingers and 10 toes, if you can touch and point to your nose, I want to tell you, you're not a robot. That's the intelligent design of the Creator Yahweh of heaven. And this song just tells you that he is, and will tell you how we know it.
My
God, thank you. You're very kind and patient with us, but there's a lot to the God that we serve. I am a simple person. God has done so much for me. I don't have time to tell it all. And so what I will do is I will share as much as I can with the little time that I have, and I pray that you see how amazing this God is. Okay? If you would just bow your heads with me for a short prayer. God, I thank you that you have given us your word as a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. You've given this to us that you would kind of lead us back to you, Father. We know in part and we understand in part. And for the limited knowledge that we have, God, yet it becomes so much when we entrust your word. We bind it about our necks. We expose ourselves to the truth of your word. And we ask, God, that you would help us to walk in such a way that when you burst the clouds of glory, we will be found worthy to see you in the clouds. We ask, God, you bless us and keep us in Jesus' name. Tonight, I want to share very briefly with you from a text in 1 Peter. So what I want to talk to you about today is just something on the order of holiness, love and holiness. Now, I told you God, the God that we serve is a loving God, right? Because of all that he's done. It's just the way that we understand love, we try to tie it back to God. So if you have a great understanding of love, then you're amazed at God. Wow! But what happens if you don't have a great understanding of love? Then you could be mad at God, right? So the Bible tells us in 1 John 4, 7 and 8, it says that, beloved, let us love one another, for God is love, and anyone who loves is born of God. But if you do not love God, then if you don't love one another, then you don't love God. You don't know who God is. It's hard to understand love unless you know how to love. So I want to read this for you because God is also a God of holiness. Okay? And for us to get to the place where we can understand love and we can understand all the things that God needs for us to understand, there's some steps we have to take. So just bear with me as we go through this real quickly. I'm going to read from 1 Peter chapter 1, and I'm going to read from verses 13 through 16. And here I read. It says, therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Here's what I want to share with you. Holiness is a requirement for God. I'm sure you've heard the word holiness before. Whenever we think of holiness, what do we think of? We start imagining angels. We start imagining perfection. We start seeing white lights and white clothing, right? Because holiness is next to purity. It means that there cannot be things that would be dark. So if some person says something that's really, really sweet, oh, she's got such a beautiful spirit. We say, oh, there's such a purity about them. It's what we see when we look at children. You know why we like to look at children? Because we know they don't have any bad intentions. Am I right? We look at little babies and what do we see? Oh, they're so beautiful. They haven't made any mistakes yet. We really should weep because we can just imagine the number of mistakes they're going to make. We should probably be weeping. But we're so overjoyed because we see the purity of this child, and we know that there's so much potential if they learn the right things. So God is a holy God. The Bible tells us that there is no darkness in God. God is so full of purity, of holiness, that he is completely light. Now, This is God the Father I'm speaking of. He has no form that you can look upon him. He's not like us. He's not flesh and blood. He's this all-powerful, ever-present. He stands on nothing. And yet he can create anything. If God doesn't have it, all he needs to do is say it, and it's just made. Now, everything you make, you have to get ingredients. You need a recipe. You got to start with something, and then you form it into something that you need. That's what we do when we bake bread, right? My son could probably tell you, he loves to bake cookies. He loves to bake bread. You need eggs and milk and flour, and he just goes on and on and on. But what I'm saying is we need to start with ingredients. But the God that I serve, he needs nothing. That's hard for us to understand. Because we often come to God and we think somehow we can impress God by what we give him and how we are. It's that God doesn't need anything from you to meet your needs. If God were to turn around, if you turn around and you look behind you, you're going to see something that's kind of moving with you. We call that what? A shadow. You know what's amazing? God doesn't have a shadow. He is so full of pure light that there is no shadow when he turns. You can't even imagine that. Because no matter where you turn, there's a shadow. That's the proof that there's sin that lurks with you. Your shadow should always remind you that sin is always there waiting for an opportunity to overtake you. But the beauty about light is it cannot exist with darkness. You turn the light on and the darkness hides under the first table it sees. Yes? There's a principle in that. As long as light, your light is shining, Satan has no chance at you. So keep the lights on. So your holiness is a light. So look at what it says here. God gives us a command in 1 Peter. And I'm looking at what it says in verse 16. He says, be holy because I am holy. Does that sound like an option to you? What God is saying to you is, I want you to be like me. Where did we hear that before? You go all the way back to Genesis, and God says in the beginning, he made man in his image, huh? To look like him, and in his likeness. Now notice there are two expressions. Image, which would be reflection, and then likeness, which would be similarity in action, behavior, character. So God intended for us to act like him. So here he confirms it. He says, so I need you then to be holy because I am holy. So your light, you need to just pull the light switch. Turn it on. When you walk into situations with people around you, turn it on. They should be able to look at you and say, there's something different about her. There's something different about Brother Butch. Is it Butch? Yes, yeah. There's something different. I mean, he gave me the... he said there's a lot that's different. Yes. You know, I'm just saying. They should be able to see that.
Oh, they do.
You did do. Right. So he's already renowned. He's already notable. So just imagine with everything that people know about you now and you turn your light on in such a way that when people see you, they see God. Wow. That's the kind of stuff that makes God stand up off his throne and come down and said, now, looky here. Look at what my boy's doing. That's how God is. He gives a standing ovation the more that we reflect him, the more that we look like him, act like him, think like him, talk like him. Why? Because that's why he made us. It is he that has made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. He said, therefore, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise because the Lord is good. He tells us to be holy. But he says this. Look at verse 15. It says, But just as he who called you is holy, so be you holy in all that you do. It tells you how to do this. You're going to have to start patterning your actions to be, you ever heard the expression, what would Jesus do? The Bible says that Jesus was put on this earth to leave us an example that we should follow. There's no excuse for us saying, well, I don't know what to do. What did Jesus do? If you don't know, I want to challenge you to find out all the things that Jesus did. It's a challenge, my challenge to you. And when I look online, I'm going to challenge Brother Greg to have kind of a testimony of how many things you have found that Jesus did, and then how many of those things you can copy. That's my challenge to you. And watch what happens when you do. Watch what God begins to remove and add into your life. Oh, she's trying really hard. Okay, I see she's got a limp. Let me just take that limp so she can walk a little bit straighter. So you're going to have some things that burden you, but as you begin to move towards God and look more like God, God starts stripping away the things that keep you from looking like him. Because his goal is to perfect you in himself. That's what he wants to do. So he says, be holy. Now, if I'm going to be holy, look at what it says. I'm going backwards here. Notice, so I start from the end product. Our goal is to be what? They all sound scared. Don't get scared. Our goal is to be
holy.
Holy, yes. Because God, the one who made us, the one who gave life to the first man and woman, and therefore to all of us, says, you are to be holy. This is not optional. I don't believe any of you would despise being in a beautiful place called paradise, called heaven. All right? I'm sure many of you have gone on vacations and you want to go to beautiful beaches and beautiful countries and lovely hotels. That's a shadow of what paradise, of what heaven is like. It can't even enter into our mind how awesome heaven is, but you got to be ready for it. So look at what it says here. It says, as obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires that you had when you lived in ignorance. Okay. In other words, before you knew better, you were following these wild desires. Okay? I'm hungry. I eat. I'm sleepy. I sleep. We just kind of followed whatever felt okay. But what God is saying is, I need something special from you. I need obedience. But obedience to what? Well, obedience to the one who made you, the manufacturer. You buy your car, it comes with a manual. You buy your TV, it comes with a manual. Just about any gadget, phone, whatever, it comes with a manual. Now, us true guys, we read no manuals, right? We figure it out by pushing 100 buttons. If something breaks, it's a manufacturer's defect. Right, guys? Amen. All right? That's how we do it. But the risk, the problem with that is that we take that same risk with ourselves. Right? It takes too much time to read the manual. The manual. Basic instructions before leaving Earth. B-I-B-L-E. The manual tells you how to treat this body, how to get to what God intended for you. But you have to figure that out. That's why I created a challenge and I said, you need to find out. Search, seek, and ye shall find. Ask, and it shall be given. Knock, and the door will be open. For everyone, he says, that asks, receives. And everyone who seeks, does find. Problem is, we give up too easy. But we are to be as obedient children. We're not to conform to the desires that we had before we came into our senses. Now, my son will get excited and strip out here in a minute. He takes clothes off and he'd walk all around. You know, just crazy. Daddy, I'm hot. You know, it's like, okay, that's fine when you're four. When you're 44 and you do that, they call some people in white for you. Right? So when you didn't know any better, there's some things you did. Paul said it this way, when I was a child, I thought as a child, I understood as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. So what God is saying here is to put away the childish things, the things that were done without understanding. You got to lay them aside. It's time to know. There's one more caveat with that. I did not know is not going to be an excuse you can use. You are going to be held accountable not only for what you do know, but for what you did not know but could have known. So, you know, some people say, don't tell me, I don't want to know. The fact that you had an opportunity to know, but you didn't take that opportunity, you're still liable. Right? If you're watching your children and your child is inquisitive, like mine is, and wants to climb and investigate and experiment, he loves experiments, this is not always a good thing. This is not always a good thing. He starts trying to get into stuff. And so as his father, I have to walk through the house with a child's mind. What would I say? Oh, yes, if I left that here, he will get to it. We'll have a problem. I have to walk through and hunt everything in the house that's out of order. Because if he sees it, he's going to find a way to play with it. I have to foresee where there might be issues in a child's mind, right? My point to you is this. You're going to be held accountable because if something happens to my child, I can't tell the cops, well, I didn't know he was going to touch that. I have to be responsible, which means I need to be aware of things that are within the sphere of my influence. I need to be. So you can't say, I never heard that. Many of us are just more willing to be, and trust me, the expression ignorance is bliss, it's true. Because in Ecclesiastes, Solomon said this, with the increase of knowledge is sorrow. The more you know, I wish I never knew that. So I hope I don't send anybody away sad tonight. I really want to encourage you with what's possible, what God has for you. I want you to know of God's best. If I didn't tell you, I'd be cheating you. So let's go back to the first verse now. This is really the crux of it all. So God says he wants us to be holy because he is holy. He wants us to be obedient, right? And do not do the things that we did when we didn't know any better. But then he goes back here at the very beginning, and he says here, therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, he said, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. Now, I'm telling you this. Jesus Christ is coming again. The time is so close. He has already told us he's coming back. And now we are in the season. We are in the toenails of time. Okay? The toenails are about to fall off. Time is about to be wrapped up. I'm just telling y'all the truth. And this is exactly why it is now time to be holy. Because he's coming back for a holy people. If you don't meet the holy stamp, he's going to have to say, I want to take you, but I can't. You don't look like me. He's coming back for those who are his. So he says, you have to be alert. You have to be sober. You have to be ready to cash in on something that God gave you. God gave you a credit card. Did you know that? Did you know God gave all of us a credit card? Well, let me tell you what the credit card is. It's called grace. It's a cash account, and it's not actually cash, but it's worth so much. It's something that you can use. Just how you go swipe your credit card and you can charge to it. This is what grace does. It allows you to access things in God by any other means you could not afford. So it says we are then saved. It says by grace we are saved through faith, not by our works, so that none of us can get proud. See what I accomplished? You should follow me. So that none of us can boast. God gave us this credit card. I'm giving this to you, son. You did not work for one penny on this credit limit. But I'm giving it to you because I love you. All I ask is you use this credit card to look more like me. Go out and buy yourself some new clothes, buy yourself a new attitude, get yourself in the right place so that when I show up and I get ready to stab all those who look like me, I'm going to say, oh, there he is, and there she is, and there she is, and there she is. That's what God wants to do. But if he can't identify you, he's going to have to skip right on over you and say, oh, sorry, I never knew you. Then he has to go and stamp the ones, and you're going to watch people get stamped. But he was sitting right next to me, and you missed me. Yeah, because you don't look like me. The reason we need to do this is because that's how Jesus is going to make his choice. My question and challenge to you is, how are you going to make your choice? I encourage you to choose the path where you look like Jesus. But it begins by, some of you already know. But even if you know, I haven't perfected it yet. There's still things like, I know it, but I just am not good at it, but I won't stop trying. I know what God wants me to do in certain areas of my life. I know I'm supposed to be patient, but boy, is it so hard, especially when you're in pain. When something has you feeling deprived or uncomfortable, you want it over now. We get impatient then, right? But I promise you, what God is teaching us when he causes us to wait, that's why the song says, they that wait upon the Lord, even though you get weary of waiting, when your strength goes empty, it says is when your strength reaches its end, God is just beginning. So it says his strength is made perfect at the end of our strength, which is our weakness. I'm telling you this, God has something so amazing for all of us. My love is expressed to you that I'm telling you the truth of God. I'm telling you that God wants to save everyone who looks like him. And I'm going to ask this question right now. Is there anybody who has a desire to be saved? Who desires that when God bursts the clouds, he can recognize you as his son, you as his daughter, you as his daughter, you as his son, you as his daughter. Do you have a desire that when God comes, that he will come back and recognize and select you and call you and said, yep, come with me. You're one of mine. Anybody has that desire today? Just wave your hand. I want you to understand, there's something powerful about the lifting of hands. Let me tell you what that is. When you lift your hands, it is a sign of surrender. Somebody points a gun at you, what's the first thing you let them know that you mean no harm? What do you do? Hey, man. That's kind of how we do. Now, unless you got a few screws loose, you go charging or trying, you know, okay, come on. You put that thing down. I'm going to show you what's up. All right? You see, there we go. He's going to outdraw him. Okay. But in most, for the lesser skill with the ammo, we go, I surrender. That's what we do. Especially if it's already pointed at you. Right? So what I'm saying to you is this. Look, I just want to invite each of you to stand with me. The raising of the hand is a sign of surrender. It says, I don't have it. I can't get it any other way. But from this way. I got one more testimony. So about 2 weeks ago, I got sick. And I guess I was doing a little bit too much, and my immune system got pretty low. And then I ended up having an outbreak of shingles. Anybody knows what that is? I'm just going to say, if you have ever had chicken pox, watch out. It does not matter how old you are. I heard for many years, oh, it only affects old people. That's a lie. Yo, you did? Okay, good. So you got your shingle shot. Yes. It is not fun at all. When this thing came up, it affected all the nerves and all the muscles, so movement hurts. And even when you say, okay, I'm not going to move, and you try to stay perfectly still, and shooting pains all through your members. It was just the arms were aching, everything hurt. The amazing thing in that experience, do you know, I didn't understand this. My arms were hurting because I felt like I was crushing lymph nodes or something. And the only time I got relief was when I did this. And then it hit me. I was walking through the house like this. And then it hit me. I was like, well, Lord, you said, you're telling me that I need to praise you more? I said, we didn't have to go through all of this. I just wondered, like, you know, what was the purpose of it? But I got my relief as I did this. And I remembered that this is how God needs for us to be in total surrender. So I want to ask you to stand with me. If you have a desire, you have this desire, I want you to just stand with me. Your stance is you're taking a stand that I'm going to try to be like the one who made me to be like him, like an obedient child. It's not an easy road now. It's going to take some effort. It's going to come with some pain and some sacrifice. But I promise you, the reward is so well worth it. Bow your heads with me. Father Almighty, you are God and God alone. You sit upon the throne. You don't even need eyes to see. Yet the Bible says that you see all. You are Jehovah El Rohi. Your knowledge that reveals everything is here amongst us now. You know every heart, every soul, every person by name, by birth, by the number of hairs on their head. You have their ID exactly matched to them. And so, God, in this, you know who they are. You know what they have need of. And today they've expressed that they desire to be like you. God, I ask that as they've made this request, they've shown this interest, I pray, God, that it would be as a covenant and that you would equip them even now, right here, where they're standing, right now, God, that your Holy Spirit would come and fill them in such a special way, God, that from this moment on, what was once hard has become easy, because with men these things are impossible, but with God all things are possible. So Father, I ask that those who desire to walk with you will just repeat this prayer after me. Heavenly Father, I come to you broken and empty. I ask God that you would fill me up with your Holy Spirit. Fill me completely. Allow me, Lord, to receive your seal for faith, hope, and love. Dear Lord, I believe Jesus Christ is my Savior, that he has covered me, that he's died for my sins, and I believe he was raised again. And so I accept by faith my salvation in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. You may be seated. Because at this time, we will go into our communion. And this is beautiful because we just established a wonderful covenant with God. I challenge you this. Smile, even when it hurts. I know. I don't know why the Lord put that in my spirit. Sometimes I'll say things that might sound crazy. But the Lord puts things in my spirit, and I just have to say, smile, even when it hurts. All right? Because what you're doing is you're training yourself not to react to feelings. Feelings are always real, but feelings are not always right. and they will lead you astray. So when we start trusting God, we can't rely on feelings anymore. We're going to rise above feelings. Feelings, you get behind me. You follow my lead. I'm following God and you follow me. You got to tell yourself how to be. I'm going to be quiet. I'm upset, so I'm going to be quiet. I'm sad, so I'm going to smile. I'm going to laugh because God has already taken care of. And watch what happened. I'm telling you stuff that I know it seems like it doesn't make sense to some of you, but I challenge you to try God. Try it God's way. All right? If you don't like it, the devil can take it back. I'm sorry. I'm messing with you. I'm messing with y'all. But you get my point. All right? You have nothing to lose. Okay? So at this time, we're going to go into our time of communion. Song we sing, the blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. I just feel led to sing this song, so just not heard it, we'll just share one verse of it. So I want you to understand the blood of Jesus never stops flowing. And it's still covering us over 2,000 years later. No matter what mistakes that you may make, always try to fall on your back. Because Proverbs says this, a just man, a man who is intended to be justified, may fall 7 times, but he gets back up again. Fall on your back, because if you can look up, you can get up. I encourage you at this point, when we take this communion, to understand that the blood never loses its power. And so, when Jesus was with the disciples, and I'm reading from 1 Corinthians in chapter 11, and I'm going to read from verse 23, it says this, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.'" I want you to understand that every time we eat this bread, drink from this cup, you are reaffirming, reestablishing this covenant of purity and holiness with God. And even if you fall, this is the place you come back to be covered again. When your clothes fall off, your spiritual garments fall off, you put them back on. But before we do that, I'm going to ask you to just take a few moments. And I just want you to talk to God. Just ask God if there's anything. And the reason why is because we need to make sure that when we come with a pure heart. If you have any anger about somebody, I need you to take that this time now and just say, "Lord, I'm going to ask you to help me to release them." If there's somebody you're angry with, I need you to help me, Lord, to release them from my right to be angry. I'm also going to ask you if there's anything that is a stumbling block, I want you to confess it right now. "God, I have this problem. I need you to help me." give me what I need to overcome this. Because as we confess our sins, it says that he is just and able to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Then when we come and we partake here, you're sealing our commitment in a new covenant that cannot fail. So just take like 1 minute, 1 to 2 minutes. Just talk to God, just between you and your Heavenly Father. As you hear every heart now, they have enough faith to trust you with every complaint, with every petition, with every burden. You said, take your yoke and learn of you, and cast all of our cares on you. So we pass it off to you now, God, so that we can come and take this communion. And God, I pray that every person who has offered up a petition, a prayer, a request for help, send help now, Lord Jesus. Allow them, God, raised from their chair in the strength of the Almighty God. You said you would uphold us with your mighty right hand. And so now, God, lift us up and carry us even when we can't carry ourselves. Lead us in the way to victory. We commit all these things to you. Forgive us of all our sins and cleanse us from all our unrighteousness as we trust you by faith in Jesus' name. Amen. We can rise. Just go ahead and praise him. I forgot. I didn't.
Seconds.
Bless God. He is good and he is able. Thank you, brother. Thank you, Brother Kevin. You're awesome and amazing, man. You got an amazing gift.
God, amazing. God is amazing.
I know. And God channels through you. And thanks for being a willing servant, my brother. Thanks for blessing us in music and in message. We've got, and along his holiness theme, sing along with us here. Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. Holiness, holiness is what you want from me. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what I long for. Faithfulness is what I need. Faithfulness, faithfulness is what you want from me. Take my heart. Righteousness is what I long for. Righteousness is what I need. Righteousness, righteousness is what you want from me. Take my heart. Take my will, take my life, take my heart, take my mind, take my will. I was hearing some awesome tickling of the fake ivories over there. Thank you, brother, for hanging around with us. I bet you know the next song too. I forgot, Brandon, no capo with this one, right?
I hope so.
We're doing Holy is the Lord in G.
We stand and lift up our hands.
For the joy of the Lord is the strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we see.
Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled with His glory. We stand and lift up our hands. Oh, the joy of the Lord is the strength. We bow down and worship Him now. How great, how awesome is He, and together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Together we sing. Everyone sing. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled with His glory. The earth is filled.
I bet you know the other one, the next one too here. We decided to do this cover, didn't we, Brandon, I think? Ish?
Sure.
I think.
Fine.
God of Wonders. And, oh, help me do the translation, Brandon. D-Capo 3.
That's just regular F.
Oh, it's regular F?
Yeah. I think we did capo one actually.
Did we really?
Yeah. So it'd be
you sure?
It'd be D sharp then, or E flat or whatever. Pick one.
Pick a chord, any chord.
As soon as I hear the first note, like,
really?
Does that sound familiar? Do you feel more comfortable with three? Because we can go back to it. It's the same as it was before, it's F.
Do it on three.
Okay.
Back to three.
I ain't saying anything.
For those of you who've never been here with us before, this is normal. This is what we do on Sunday nights. Tabernacle. Beautiful. Beautiful. God is good. God is able. He is holy. He is holy. You're kind of catching a theme here. You tell me you gave me his message, and maybe you changed the name of it, but I remember holiness pertaining to love, I think is what I wrote down. So I found a lot of cool songs with holy and holiness. As a matter of fact, the one song was actually a new one. The first song we did on PR actually was a new one we'd not done before. What did we decide on this? We're doing Cable, aren't we?
I think we did cover.
You remember how that goes? This is usually a piano. Here. I bet he knows. Okay. Word of God speak. Mercy me. Finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard. Sing along with us. But to hear what you would say, word of God speak, would you pour down my grace? In the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, I hear your voice. Word of God speak, would you pour at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. Good. All right, we're going to toss an extra one on here for you because we love you, and just because we wanted to play one more song. So, do I have under S for so? You're not going to have any words up on there with it. Oh. Oh, you want to do best seat? Yeah, let's do that. That's upbeat. Brandon went to end upbeat. Okay, this is a song called The Best Seat in the House, which, by the way, each one of you have it, right? By a group called Blackberry Smoke. I haven't played this in a while. I'm trying to remember.
He'll be good.
Keyboard. This is a keyboard organ sound. If you're, you know what? This guy over here, Jonathan, he kind of gets his groove on. You kind of watch what he adds in here.
Y'all don't.
Thanks, everybody, for hanging out with us tonight. It is Sunday. Tomorrow is Monday. We didn't have Bruce here to tell us what day it was.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, God is good and God is able. Hey, if you want to listen to the awesome message again, just go to familiesforhim.org. That's families, F-O-R-H-I-M.org, all right? Remember, families, I-E-S. And Kevin, thank you. Thank you, brother. Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, Anita. Thank you, Caleb. Awesome master, dude. He's wearing red. He matched the tablecloth. I couldn't see him. All right, remember, your healing, it belongs to you because of what Jesus has done. We will see you next Sunday.